thank you for that generous introduction. Thank you for teaching me a little bit more about Nebraska. I did not know about Mayhew Cabin, so I hope next time I'm lucky enough to be in your state, you will take me there and we can visit it together. I would love that. Even more, thank you for all of the important and vital work you do through the Sherwood Foundation and all of your philanthropic endeavors to improve the lives of children and young people here in Omaha and around the country and increasingly around the world. We need more leaders like you, and we are very lucky to have you. And I'm very grateful for our work together with Too Small to Fail, which is our initiative at the Clinton Foundation to try to close the word gap. Because access to words, to books, to literacy shouldn't be a privilege in our country, and yet too often it is. So I'm really excited to be here today because I love libraries and I love librarians and I love books. My first memory is actually tumbling down the stairs and then my mother comforting me by snuggling me on her lap and reading Goodnight Moon together. That's truly my first memory. And so many of my most favorite memories from childhood revolve around books and reading. And of my book club of two with my very best friend, Elizabeth Fleming, our mothers met in Lamaze class. She's 6 weeks older than I am. We've known each other our entire lives. And we spent much of our young lives together reading books. We read the entire catalog up to that point of Nancy Drew, Hardy Boys, Nancy Drew and Hardy Boys, Sweet Valley Twins, Sweet Valley High, Harriet the Spy, Encyclopedia Brown, and on and on and on. And those books were kind of the vehicle through which we really kind of built our friendship, explored the world together, kind of thought about who we wanted to be as girls, later as women, and importantly, as friends and citizens. I remember racing out of church every Sunday across the street to the Little Rock Central Public Library to check out another book on Eleanor of Aquitaine or the ancient Egyptians. And I am so grateful to the librarians there who always were very patient with my endless questions. And I'm really grateful to my parents who made sure that I always paid my library fees out of my allowance so that I kind of learned that responsibility early on, and also kind of the respect of other kids who might be equally eagerly awaiting kind of whatever books I borrowed. I'm so thankful to the librarians that I had at Booker, my elementary school in Little Rock, for allowing me to read truly endless backlogs of National Geographic magazines and helping to direct me to a book that would later really change my life, 50 Simple Things Kids Can Do to Save the Earth. That book kind of was the first book that I read that really helped me feel empowered, helped me feel a real responsibility to try to make a difference in my school community and then in my home and kind of later in the broader world. I would reflect back on that book a couple decades later when I decided I wanted to write a book for middle readers to help share stories of some of the remarkable change makers that I had been lucky enough to know and support and work alongside, and to share some of kind of what I was hearing kind of young people were really interested in, engaged in, angry about, inspired to do something about. And that was then my first book, It's Your World. And so I'm just so thankful that kind of now the great honor that I have to write books that I hope kind of resonate and speak to young readers today. There's certainly books that I wish I would have had as a young reader in elementary school or junior high school, kind of that work for me really started back in my elementary school library. So it just gives me such great joy to be in a room with librarians today, to be able to say thank you, and to share kind of any thoughts that might be interesting or useful to you as you continue to make the case for why what you do is so critical, kind of why we should think of words and access to words and literacy-rich environments kind of in the same breath that we think about kind of clean water, kind of nutritious food, kind of physical education for our youngest Americans. So really, just with tremendous gratitude, I want to invite Kira up to kind of have a conversation. And you don't strike me as a retiring audience, so I hope you will ask questions about kind of my life as an author or as a young reader or kind of anything else that kind of might be on your minds or in your hearts. And again, I just want to say how great it is to be in Nebraska and kind of with Susie and so many women who I know kind of have persisted and are persisting to help improve the lives for children and families across your state, and then really help inspire so many across our country. So thank you so much, Kira. Know their stories recently, but all of whom I find really inspirational And it means a lot to me that both my daughter and my son like hearing these stories, because I think it's really important that we share stories of strong, empowering women with our daughters and with our sons, so that our sons grow up expecting women to do great things.
Absolutely. Amen to that. On the subject of children's health, the Clinton Foundation is a global leader on health issues, especially for children. What do you see right now as the greatest threat or challenge to children's health worldwide and maybe in this country as well? And what advice do you have that we need to be doing on a grassroots level to address some of these?
Well, I think there are different and yet maybe the same answers to the global and the U.S. focus question. The same answer is that we do know a lot about what we need to do kind of from prenatal health kind of through to when someone is 18 to help ensure that that child has every opportunity to lead a healthy, thriving life. And yet, so often, we don't provide what children need, either in this country or around the world. Kind of the inequalities that exist in kind of access to medicine, to medical care, to kind of good public health, to health literacy, kind of though varies across our country, but really around the world. So if we think around the world, we still have hundreds of thousands of children who die every year from severe dehydration due to diarrhea. And no one should die of severe dehydration due to diarrhea. We know how to prevent most of what causes the children to get sick in the first place, through vaccinations against rotavirus, for example. We know how to replenish a child who is severely dehydrated so that kind of their homeostasis can again be established in a healthy, kind of health protective way. And yet, so often children aren't still getting the vaccinations that I think every child should have, or aren't able to get kind of the therapies that they need to save their lives, even though they're quite simple and not expensive. Also, if we look around the world, we still have hundreds of thousands of children who die every year due to malaria, even though, again, we know how to prevent malaria, we know how to treat malaria, and yet so often the most vulnerable children are not being protected against it or getting the treatments they need. So in this country, we don't have people, thankfully, dying of malaria, although we did not that long ago, and severe dehydration due to diarrhea happens, but often because of criminal neglect and not a failure in public health or kind of the health system. But in this country, we know we need to be doing more to ensure that every woman has access to the full complement of prenatal care that I would argue every new mother should have access to, that every child comes into the world safely with a trained midwife, trained doctor, kind of in a safe, secure, environment, and that then that child gets the care that she or he deserves just by virtue of kind of having been born, but so often isn't the care that we provide our children, particularly children who live in kind of our most rural and our most urban environment. So I think when you ask, I care what you can do, I think I think for me it was really so important that I was given that book, 50 Simple Things Kids Can Do the Earth. Do to save the earth, because I was 10 or 11, and my librarian recognized that I was curious about the world and I wanted to be kind of fed and nurtured in this way, but also recognized that I had the privilege of security and time to then think about what I could do to save the earth. So I think one of the things that you all are uniquely positioned to do is to try to help students who are not privileged, recognize that they're not alone, and that if they're feeling like it's inequitous, it is inequitous, and that is a really valid, valuable feeling, and to then kind of help direct that toward what, like citizen activism, I think now is really possible for kids in a way that wasn't 30 years ago when I was in second grade. But also for children who kind of have time, space, support from their parents' resources, to really be able to engage, to change the world, to help support that too. Because I think for those of us who are privileged, we should expect us to
blessings, you know, as early as possible. And I think probably all of you in this room today are really well equipped to kind of be in the best sense of service and kind of support, encouragement, and inspiration to children who are privileged and also to children who aren't. And I think the answers and ways to best engage, support, inspire, you know, are very different. And I think they're all really important.
So I just got a great question from the audience. Someone asked, what advice do you wish someone had given your 10-year-old self that I, the person asking, can share with my 10-year-old daughter?
Oh, wow. Well, I would say, one, I always, I have 20 nieces and nephews. My husband has 10 brothers and sisters. So our children are the 21st and 22nd grandchildren from my mother-in-law. Which I actually think is awesome for them because I'm an only child, and so it's just great that they have like this kind of multiple teams worth of cousins. And the reason that I start with that is I'm really kind of in such a lucky position because I get to hear like from our nieces and nephews like what they're thinking about, what they care about, how those answers now have changed over time. So my husband and I have been together for more than a dozen years. So I would say, not yet being the mother of a 10-year-old, my children are 1.5 and 3.5, is to first listen, because I think kind of the right answer to that question really depends on what kind of your daughter cares about. And I think both inspiration and anger are really actually exciting and catalytic places to start to engage in changing the world for the better, whether you want to help do more of something or you want to stop something bad from happening. And what I wish I had kind of better understood at 10 was I wish I'd been a little bit less afraid. Because while I was kind of blessed with two loving parents and deeply kind of privileged to not have to worry about a roof over my head or food on the table or a good school to go to, I think I still fell into that trap that we sadly know so many young people, particularly young girls, fall into of like everything has to be perfect. Like I remember when I was making my recycling plan, like to try to convince my school that we should introduce recycling, thanks to 50-something things kids can do to save the earth. Like I remember, remember those old-fashioned printers that used to have the perforated?
Yeah.
Like I kept printing it off, and like the words kept like being too close to like one side. So I think I actually went to the local public library and like printed it all out again. Like, was that really worth like the hours of my life to get there? Probably not. Like, was the principal really gonna notice like the words that were like a little too close to the edge? Maybe, maybe not. Would that really have influenced her decision to like allow me and like the few kids I've recruited to help us do the recycling program? Probably not. So while I appreciate that I do have like an attention to detail, I wish I'd been a little bit less afraid and a little bit kind of willing to move a little more quickly and focused on kind of the intent instead of kind of what was going into that. I wish I'd known that at 10.
So I have another question of my own before I get to some other audience questions. So the folks in this room, librarians, educators, we care very deeply about information literacy, news literacy, good information. And the last year or so, we've been sort of struggling with the idea of the bubble, the information bubble, or the social media bubble. So I'm just curious, how do you break out of the bubble, so to speak? What are your go-to trusted sources for news and perspectives?
Well, I think these are somewhat different questions. I mean, I really worry that we kind of think everything is still up for debate. Like, vaccines are not up for debate. Mm-hmm. Like, I realize there are lots of different views about this. People have very intense feelings. I really believe in science. I also am lucky enough for our work with the Clinton Health Access Initiative, in our work to try to help lower the price of vaccines around the world, that I'm able to see like truly the millions of lives that we've had an impact on because children now are getting sick with rotavirus, which is the kind of single leading cause of severe dehydration that can lead to death. And so, I struggle with kind of often this question of like perspectives getting lumped together with facts. I think we can have different perspectives around like how much of your time should you spend on helping kids access things online or reading like old-fashioned books, or how much time should you spend helping kids read books without pictures or with pictures or graphic novels. Like, I have no idea what the right answer to that is, and I bet you all have like really interesting answers to that question. And I bet you have really interesting answers to that question for like kids of different ages. So that I think we can debate. But I worry a little bit at this moment, partly because of the bubbles that you've talked about, kind of we've created this sense of like all of you somehow deserve equal footing. All views about questions that we haven't answered because we don't have data yet, and we haven't really had the chance to research them, or because we just haven't lived with the kind of phenomenon of social media yet, that kind of we couldn't possibly yet have enough good data around how best to encourage kids to kind of learn and engage, kind of be readers, whatever that might mean in this moment. But that's different to me than like the quote unquote debates that we still have about vaccines. Right? So I think one of the things that you're really well positioned to do is to help kids understand what the difference is between kind of science and data, like information from reliable sources because of how it's been generated, determined, assessed, versus opinions. Like, I think that's hugely important, or anecdotal stories. Like, I think you all are so well positioned and really crucial to help kids understand how to be, and I don't even know what the right way to frame this is, like information literate in some ways. And so I hope that, you know, if there's anything I can ever do to try to help you do that, like you'll ask me to help, because I care so deeply about trying to ensure that children, regardless of kind of what issues they may choose to care about, kind of what political party may feel right to them, kind of what part of the country they want to live in or work in or what they want to do, that everyone have a good distinction between, like, right, these are facts as we used to really know them, and I think have to get back to understanding, and these are our opinions, and the opinions we really should debate and have vigorous conversations about, because we don't really know necessarily what the right answer is for the most people in the most places.
So there's a question about net neutrality here. So with the recent FCC sort of rollback of some of the net neutrality progress, what do you think that communities can do to ensure school and library access to affordable broadband?
Well, I would say one, thankfully, you know, there are people in the Senate and the House who are trying to have a legislative remedy for this. So I would say, you know, certainly if this is something that you care about, like, please support those efforts and urge your senators and congresspeople to be on what you believe, and I also believe, is the right side of this issue. And the second thing I would say is that there are really interesting things happening at the state level. So, you know, I would look at like what Montana is doing, for example, to effectively demand net neutrality for all of its service providers and telecom companies in the state, and to effectively act as if the new FCC ruling like hasn't happened, partly because of how reliant so many communities and families are on the rural concessions for broadband, not only in public schools and libraries, but often kind of in workplaces and homes as well. So I think I would continue to push for a legislative remedy at the federal level. I also though would look at like some of what's happening at the state level, because although Montana was the first state to do this, I know other states are actively kind of looking at what Montana has done. So I think there are ways to still ensure kind of equity of access, even if it's not as easy as getting the FCC to reverse its ruling. I do think there are real ways forward, and we're seeing that already happen.
So this event over the next 2.5 days or so is all about partnerships, all about collaboration. So I'm curious, in your work with the foundation, and also your work as an author, as a creative person, how do you approach, decide on, cultivate partnerships, collaborations? You know, when is that moment where you know, yeah, this is the right fit, this is going to work, I want to partner with this person or this organization?
Well, at the foundation, you know, I mentioned briefly our Too Small to Fail work. Our Too Small to Fail work, which started in 2014 in an effort to raise awareness about and then try to help close the word gap. So I'm sure all of you know this, but you know, I still think so many people don't. The 30 million more words that your children from a two-income, middle-class family will have heard versus a child from, you know, a single-parent, working-class family will have heard, you know, by the time they're three, right? So then that only exaggerates over time. And we focus on that because 80% of our brains are built by the time we're three. Like the scaffolding of our brains is really constructed in those early years. And so at Too Small to Fail, while we generated lots of kind of content and information, we knew to really disseminate that and also to really help kind of close not only the word gap, but the book gap, we had to do it in partnership. And so we've had, I think, really interesting partners, partly because they're unexpected, and I think they've been really effective. But again, that's what I think. We're now going through multiple independent evaluations run of Emory and Harvard School of Public Health to see whether or not like what we think is actually kind of borne out by the data. So just a few examples. We've partnered with the Coin Laundry Association. So now we have in the 8,000 members of the Coin Laundry Association across the country, kind of prompts for parents to read, sing, talk to their kids about the laundry or about anything else that they might want to while they're in the laundromat. And that's so important because like a working class, urban family will spend an average of 4 hours a week in the laundromat. And so that's real time that can be productive time to kind of read, sing, and talk with their kids. And we've partnered with multiple mega churches around the country because we know that they have a real focus on early spiritual education, and so ensuring that early literacy can be woven into that, and that it's not only through kind of reading the stories from the Bible, it's talking to children about the stories from the Bible, even if they can't talk back yet, expecting them to have an opinion, nurturing the value of an opinion, of their viewpoint, kind of validating that from an early age is something that we've also found really meaningful. We've partnered with grocery stores around the country, so kind of prompts to talk about the vegetables or the fruit or the cereal, kind of the places where parents are probably spending time with their kids, like as they're pushing the grocery cart around with the kid, kind of with her, his legs dangling through the grocery cart to make that time really productive, kind of reading, singing, and talking to kids. We partnered with the American Association of Pediatricians so that now, kind of on the sheet of kind of guidelines for what should be in a pediatrician's visit, pediatricians are now expected to ask, like, do you read, sing, and talk to your kids? And we partnered with Scholastic to give out initially a couple hundred thousand books to pediatricians' offices so that there are books kind of while families are waiting to see the pediatrician that kind of are right there immediately, both in English and Spanish. We've partnered with multiple publishers to now include books with diaper batches for diaper banks. You know, diaper need is a serious need in our country. Yeah, about 10% of families struggle to buy the diapers that their children need in the early years of life and then rely on diaper banks to help close that kind of diaper gap for themselves. So we've partnered kind of with Huggies and Pampers to now include a book and the bundle of diapers that they're donating to the diaper bank. So to really go where families are, either to help provide books, we've now helped provide close to a million books in these different settings, and also to provide prompts, whether kind of laundromats or also playgrounds. We now have a partnership where we're kind of putting kind of stories like on the sides of playground equipment, kind of prompts on literally the bottoms of swings, like sing a swing, like that sound might sound silly, but kind of it gets people kind of thinking and hopefully then reading, singing, and talking to their kids.
I love all of these ideas. I think this room, it really resonates with a lot of the work we do in early learning. So this is a great one. Someone asked, can you please talk about your thoughts on literacy as a social justice issue?
Well, I think it's a huge social justice issue. I mean, if we think about book deserts, right, in Anacostia, at least kind of from research that we know of, Anacostia, right across from Washington, D.C., is the kind of single largest book desert in the United States, right? There's one book for every 833 kids. So, you know, I find that like outrageous and inequitous, and I think it's absolutely a social justice issue because we know how important the early years are to kind of setting someone's trajectory in life. And yet, despite all of the research that we have, kind of from Yale or Columbia or University of Chicago or elsewhere, saying that kind of the return on investment that you get for investing in those early years of life with nutritional support, with social emotional support, with early learning initiatives, you know, we haven't really been able to persuade Congress or even most state legislatures that kind of making investments in those early years are so important. And yet, all the evidence says it is really vital. And I certainly think kind of with headline statistics like what I just quoted from Anacostia, and while it's the most extreme, it's certainly not singular. Kind of we have book and word deserts across our country that are clearly linked to then intergenerational perpetuation of inequality. And so I think if anyone cares about kind of social justice and disrupting that intergenerational kind of structural inequality persisting, you have to care about the word gap and the book gap and kind of ensuring that more children in more places have literacy-rich environments. So yes, I absolutely think it's a social justice issue.
Somewhat related to that, there was another question in here about getting the conversation about the importance and necessity of libraries sort of on the national level. And we sometimes talk about how public libraries in particular and school libraries as well kind of have a PR problem. You know, it's hard to kind of sometimes get that message out at a broad scale, what it is that we do. You know, oftentimes even family members will say, well, are there really libraries? Doesn't everyone just Google everything? Isn't that going, you know, the way of the dinosaur? And it's just, you know, eye roll inducing. Do you have any advice for how librarians and the library community can sort of do a better job of getting our message out sort of at a broad national level?
Oh, I wish I did. I would say my first reaction when you were saying, like, people roll their eyes, I would say, I bet they have lots of books at home. Mm-hmm. I mean, that kind of, I think, is maybe the crux of the problem, right? Candidly. I mean, to now be really candid, is that the people that you're trying to convince, this is not a problem for. And so I do think part of then the challenge is how do we ensure that more people think it's a social justice issue? How do we ensure that more people kind of not only believe kind of academically but morally kind of in the case for investing in early childhood education and also investing broadly in book access kind of throughout a child's life?
Speaking of books, someone else wants to know, are you reading any good books right now? What would you recommend this room to be reading?
Oh my gosh, I think that you probably have like really good recommendations for me. I'm so thankful that both our children love to read so much. And so, like, at the moment, can you ask me what my favorite books are? And like, both my children just cannot get enough of Mobilums. Like, we read so much Mobilums. And like, now my son like looks for the pigeon everywhere. Not hiding under a couch. I've read lots of good nonfiction recently, but I do need some good new fiction. So please.
Well, librarian.
Like, advice is welcome.
What genres do you like in fiction?
Are you
like a
thriller? Oh my gosh.
Historical fiction.
I love historical fiction. I don't like anything where children are harmed. Once I became a parent, I just couldn't, like, I couldn't read that any longer. I can't read mysteries any longer, like, where children are harmed. I can't read mysteries where children are missing. I can't do it. Like, I don't have the ability to distance myself. So I would say that's what I have no interest in. The books don't always have to have a happy ending. I just need there to not be an unhappy ending that involves a child having an unhappy ending. Or the catalyst for the story being, or the pen, anything. Nothing about children being hurt or harmed at all. And so I love historical fiction. I love learning about kind of other places in the world. So not just other times in our world history, but other places in the world. And so I've loved like the Barbara Nadala mysteries that are set in Istanbul. Like I love kind of the window that books give me into kind of other aspects of our global community or other aspects of our kind of history?
I think this room will probably work on a list for you before you leave here today. So a little leader's advisory. So another question I had, you know, we've been talking about how critical it is for all of us and youth in particular to be empowered to raise their voices and speak out, especially in times when fundamental rights are at stake. And we've recently seen pretty incredible models of youth stepping up. You know, you've got the Parkland teen, you've got the youth organizers of Black Lives Matter. And on one hand, it's incredibly inspiring, but part of it also concerns me, this idea that, you know, we've got these children taking to the streets, you know, to defend their lives, kind of signals that maybe the grown-ups have kind of failed in some fundamental ways here. So, you know, what advice do you have for the grown-ups in this room, how we can not just empower, but also support this next generation, you know, to keep raising their voices, but also not burn out?
I think the kind of right answers to those questions are probably as many as the young people engage, right? I think certainly continuing to listen to young people and to support kind of young people in their activism, how to ensure that someone doesn't become burned out or beleaguered, I think is probably the right answer for that is different for every person, but hopefully being attentive to it means that kind of we can help protect them kind of from that in some ways. And one of kind of the elements that I found so inspiring about, particularly what you just mentioned, like the Parkland students or the Youth for Black Lives, is this recognition that kind of being in a community kind of not only hopefully helps it sustain the movement, kind of in some ways they found their natural partners to your earlier question, but also hopefully means that no one is ever going to feel guilty if they do need to take a little bit of time for themselves to replenish themselves or restore themselves because they know there are other people kind of carrying forward. And I think that's a really kind of profound and mature recognition from so many of the young people who've really stepped forward that it's not singular, that it is kind of from the beginning by design, kind of in collaboration, kind of with a community of kind of like-minded, like-purposed, kind of similarly focused individuals.
That's good advice for us as well. So you have a new book coming out that was just announced this morning. Can you tell us a little bit about that book and when it comes out and what it's all about?
Yeah, thank you. I'm very excited. So I'll talk a little bit about how the book came about, and then I'll talk about the book. So it's called Start Now, and it comes out on October 2nd. And it really emerged from my experience of being on book tour for It's Your World and then the conversations I've had subsequent to it. So I wrote It's Your World in some ways for some of my nieces and nephews and their friends, like these 10 to 14-year-olds that I've been lucky enough to spend time with and listen to and learn from, and kind of stories that I wanted to share of young people in that age group who are making a real difference kind of in their schools, in their communities, kind of sometimes really around the world. And yet I so often was asked, like, by the younger siblings, kind of the readers who would come to my events, like, are you going to write a book for me? Or, like, what about even younger kids? Can we do something? And this kept kind of coming up, so I thought, well, I should then write a book kind of for even younger readers, because there are some really amazing things happening kind of in elementary schools around the country, kind of individual students or again groups of young students that are kind of transforming kind of their communities, but also what they're proving is possible for even kind of very young change makers. And so then I spent a lot of time with kids listening to them about issues they cared about and kind of what they didn't know but they wanted to know and kind of what they wanted to know was possible or not for them. And so I wrote kind of Start Now to kind of answer these questions of kind of what even younger readers are doing, kind of what is possible, kind of what have I heard kind of they want to know to be able to springboard into action to tackle issues that they really care about. And really interestingly, like what I kind of heard a lot about was bullying, sadly, not surprisingly at this moment, though sadly, the environment, an intense focus on animals and what kind of kids could do to help animals, and also an intense realization, I think partly because we do now have more conversations happening about this around, like how can they help themselves be healthier? Like what do they need to be doing to be healthy from a young age, and how can they help kind of their friends be healthy? And so kind of this real sense of nurture and support for themselves, kind of for their friends, for their classmates, was something that I really wanted to speak to and to try to help inform and empower.
You said October 2nd.
October 2nd.
Excellent. Well, I want to thank you, Chelsea, so much. We are going to take a quick break, but then we're going to come back out, and you'll be signing copies of books out here, and you'll have an opportunity.
And you'll hopefully give me fiction recommendations.
Yes.
Great.
Get your reader's advisory caps on. It's going to be great. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.